Good evening. This week and next Tuesday I'm still here, then I go to Israel. So we will have 2 weeks off, we'll be back in Hanukkah, middle of Hanukkah. Just follow my calendar on my website. Just follow the calendar, please. We will speak about Parashat Toldot. But before we speak about Parashat Toldot, I want to speak a few words about the last week's Haftarah that I didn't get to speak about it yet. The Haftarah of Parashat Chaye Sarah, speaking about David HaMelech, King David, 7 years old, it's the last days of his life. And the connection between the Haftarah and the Parashat, there always has to be a connection. That's why they read the Haftarah, to remind us about the Parashot that the Romans did not allow us to read. So they will remind us when the time comes, what Parashah we used to read in this Shabbat. That's the concept of reading Haftarah from the Navi, from the prophets. So we know that Avraham Avinu passed everything he had to his son Yitzchak. He had also Ishmael. And in the end, he gave everything to Yitzchak. Just like Hashem said to Avraham, Ishmael is nothing. Be'Yitzchak yikare lecha zera, zara. Yitzchak is your inheritance. Ishmael did not get from him any inheritance. He sent him, you know, some minor things, and that's it. But the ones who got actually everything, and he continued the way of Avraham, it's Yitzchak. Avraham zaken menatan et kol asher lo leYitzchak. Everything he has, he gave to Yitzchak. And the same concept is in the Haftarah. David HaMelech is about to pass from this world, and he has many children, as you know. And one of them is Adonia ben Chagit. You know, and he is already making himself the new king. It's a, if you want to learn about politics, everything that you see today in politics, whether it's in Israel or America, you read the Haftarah of last week. The lesson in politics, how politics work. So, his son Adonia realized that his father is passing away. He knew 100% that his preferred son is Shlomo, King Solomon. He's supposed to inherit him. He's his son from Bathsheba, the real love of David HaMelech, Bathsheba. It was his real shiduch. He gave her to Uriah Hiti after he killed Goliath. He was so happy from the moment that the Jewish nation got saved from slavery, because they said to the Philistines, instead of killing each other in a war, let's make one-on-one. You take your hero, and we get our hero. They let them fight one against one. Whoever will win, the loser nation will all become slaves for them. So like this, there won't be bloodshed. And small David HaMelech, compared to this giant Goliath, was cursing Hashem, coming with his ego. Who is this Goliath? Where did this monster come from? How a monster like this, lazy and arrogant, and so big and scary, how does it come to the world, such a monster? The answer, the night that Naomi, after her two sons died, they marry Goyot, right? Machlon and Kilion, they marry Goyot, and Hashem took them away from the world, as we see that Hashem doesn't like intermarriage. He wants the Hebrews or the Jewish nation to always stay in one nation. Converts is a different story. But here, they left Israel, they went overseas after wealth. They didn't make Hashem happy. He took them from the world young. But they have two daughter-in-laws. One is Ruth, and one is Orpah. Ruth and Orpah. And their mother-in-law is Naomi. So Naomi is going now towards Eretz Israel over there, and they want to join her. So she said to them, no, you don't have to. Go back to your nation. You don't need to. What do you need to? So Ruth said, your God is my God. Your country is my country. Wherever you go, I will go. She refused to leave her alone. So what happened? She stuck with her. Orpah went, That night she became pregnant, and who was born? This monster, Goliath. You understand how life is? It's a choice of a moment. If Orpah would stick to her like with Ruth, like Ruth did, maybe we wouldn't have this monster born. It's all a chain reaction. So what happened here? This Goliath is fighting David HaMelech. David HaMelech killed him, but he needs to chop his head off to bring it to the Philistines as a sign that your hero is dead. But the problem is, he has a giant head. You cannot cut his head with a little kitchen knife. You need a massive sword. Which sword you need? His own sword. And he doesn't know how to open the nut of the sword. The sword, he has a very complicated nut. There's no way to open it. So, out of nowhere, one sentence came out of his mouth. How much he regretted that sentence, you have no idea in his life. How much he suffered because of that. He said, the one who will open this nut will get the greatest Jewish girl to be his wife. Who came? Uriah Hitti. Goy, convert, not clear what he was. Hitti, it's one of the nations that are cursed. There are seven nations that the Torah cursed them. Aprizi, Aknaani, Aevusi, Achivi, all these nations that are all idol worshippers, they live in Israel, and Hashem threw them out of Israel when the Jews came. So that means none of these nations are good. They're all idol worshippers. The Torah say, do not leave any memory from them. Dig the ground under their idols. Make sure you purify the land from these filthy nations. That means it's not coming from a good nation. Even Eliezer Eved Avraham is Eved Knaani, from the land of Knaan, from the people of Knaan. He himself was very righteous. He was one of the 10 people who went to heaven without dying. Bechayehem Hashem took them. Without, like Moshe Rabbeinu. Like there's 10 people that the Gemara mentioned. There's one of them, Eliezer Eved Avraham. A few other goyim, 2-3 more goyim there, that righteous goyim. That Hashem took them to Olam Haba, mamash like that, in a very special way. So Eliezer Eved Avraham, as the Torah says, very righteous, is very faithful to Avraham. But Avraham refused to marry his son Yitzchak to his daughter. Why? Only because of the reason that he comes from a cursed nation, the nation of Canaan. Who cursed Canaan? Who cursed this nation? Noach, his grandfather. Canaan was the fourth son of Ham. Ham castorized Noach. He made him unable to have more kids. When Noach woke up from his wine, he saw damage in his body. He realized, Vayaret asher asa lo bno. He realized what happened. And then he said, Arur Canaan. He did not curse directly Ham. He cursed his fourth son. He had four sons. Who are they? He had Cush, Canaan, Put, and Mitzrayim. Canaan was the youngest out of the four. So Noach, even Noach, like Hashem, when he cursed, measure for measure, midah keneged midah, you made me unable to have the fourth child, right? I have Shem, Ham, and Yefet. I wanted to have more kids. You made me unable to have my fourth child. I'm going to curse your fourth child who was already born. Midah keneged midah. And there's also another explanation that Canaan was the one who saw his grandfather naked. Instead of running and covering him, he called his father to come see. You understand? Doesn't make that much of a sense here, but this is what he did. He cursed him. From that moment on, the curse is that he will be cursed, Arur, and will be slaves to his brothers, to other nations. Canaan. So Eliezer, as you can see, is a servant, like a slave, of Avraham Avinu. But he's a very righteous slave. But still, doesn't make sense. I am blessed. The children of Avraham are blessed. And the children of Canaan are always cursed. Cursed and blessed cannot form a family together. It's like water and fire. They don't go together. It's a problem. So what happened? So we see that this Uriah Hitti, which came from one of those nations that were in Israel, he ran quickly and he opened the nut. How did he know? He is the one who made the knot. He was the servant of Goliath. So the one that made the knot is the only one who knows how to open it. So he ran quickly and opened the knot, and Hashem say, David HaMelech, you have a holy mouth. You decreed that he's going to get the greatest Jewish girl. Your girl is the best one. You're the best Jew, and you're the best girl is for you. Mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav, like the Gemara in Masechet Sota, page 2. The Gemara say, tell me who you are, I'll tell you who your wife's going to be. You're going to be in a higher level, spiritually, your shidduch will get an upgrade. The only thing that the Gemara said that they already announced who is going to be your wife before you even born, it's only in the first life, first reincarnation, bezivug rishon. But from then on, meaning in the first time, when you came to the world for the first time, you did not make sins yet. You don't bring sins from previous life. You are a brand new soul. So everyone is brand new. So everyone can marry everyone because everyone is in the same level. They're all pure with no sins. So there's no problem. So Hashem has to make an announcement. Who I'm going to put with who? A with B, C with D, right? And Hashem makes the announcement for the first reincarnation. After they live the life, they died with a mark. They did a lot of good things. They did a lot of bad things. Everyone has a rating. Now, if I send you back to the world for another life, I take your soul and I put it in a new body. When you come to the world, when you grow up, at the time when I want you to get married, I evaluate your spiritual level. If you're very high, you're Ben Torah, Talmid Chacham, you're honest, you have good midot, I'll get you the greatest girl. And if you're a faker and a loser, that's what you're going to get. Like the Gemara in Masechet Sota is very, very precise. It's very interesting. Many people don't pay attention. So the Gemara say, "Mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav," right? A person gets a zivug according to his actions. But the Gemara also say one more thing. Rashi actually writes there, "Prutza la'rasha, tznua la'tzadik." Very interesting. A prutza means a woman that is very not modest, whether in her clothing or in her behaving or actions. So she's prutza. And she goes with a wicked person, with a wicked man. And tznua, very modest, dress, behaving, you know, very classy. She goes with the righteous one. So it's very interesting because by the ladies, there's no such thing righteous and wicked. No such thing. By the men, there's tzaddik and rasha, wicked and righteous, yes? By the women, there's no such thing. There's only one thing, it's important, above everything. If you have it, you're righteous. If you don't have it, you're wicked. Doesn't matter. The rest is, of course, everything is matter, but it's the main thing on a weight, on a scale. What is it? Modesty. If you're a modest woman, automatically you like have 60%. You pass the test. Now the rest is going to add more to your mark. If you be Baalat Chesed, and you keep Shabbat, and you eat kosher, everything is important. But if you're already modest, automatically you have a check, tzadeket. That's it, you're righteous already. And if you're not dressed modestly, and you don't behave modestly, and you have friends on Facebook, and all this nonsense that happens today in the world, you cannot be righteous. Even if you keep a lot of mitzvot, righteous you cannot be. You keep mitzvot, and you're going to get your reward for it, of course. But tzadeket you're not. Why? Because you're not tzanua. You're not tzanua, you can never be tzadeket. That's the rule number one. It's like the foundation of the house. You don't have a foundation, it doesn't matter what you're going to build. Anyway, it's not going to last. It goes by tznua or prutza. That's what it is. So, since Batsheva is the greatest woman on earth at that time, 3,000 years ago, instead of going to David like Hashem planned, he had to take her now and give it to this Uriah Hitti. She's arrogant, disrespectful, all kinds of problems he has with him. And what happened later on? David had to make all kinds of tricks. You know, like they say in Israel, kasher aval masriach. Kosher, but smells bad. You know what I'm talking about? You can take meat now. Extremely good. Glad kosher, bet Yosef, halak, but already a week old. Kasher. Then you have very fresh meat, red, nice, just 2 minutes ago the animal was slaughtered. But not kosher, not kosher. Which one makes more impression? The non-kosher meat, fresh, smells delicious. You want to eat it raw, it looks so good. The other one, already brown, dark. Ugh. After you grill it, still tastes horrible. Now you have to eat one of the two. Which one you have to eat? The kosher. Close your nose and eat. The other one you can eat. You eat, it's a very big sin. So this is what David HaMelech had to do. To get what's his with tricks. You understand? I'll give you an example. Let's say Reuven owe you money. $1,000. I refuse to pay. You know he owes you the money. He's a crook. He doesn't want to pay. You wait a year, two, three. One day, you hear someone say to somebody, listen, I have a friend in town, his name is Reuven, such and such. I want to send him some money. Would you help me, do me a favor and take the money to him? So you say, no, I live actually right next to him. I'll give him the money. How much you have there? $1,000. And he owe you $1,000. No problem, you can count on me. You take the $1,000, say, call Reuven, tell him he paid me. He doesn't owe me the $1,000. Kasher, but smells bad. Especially if you somebody holy, doesn't look good. Adamo said, din latzmo, in case like this. He came to my hand. You owe me the money. That's your money. It's not your money. It's my money. You never paid. I only took what's mine. But everybody agreed that if something like this would be published, it doesn't smell so good. Like the Gemara said that one of the Rabbanim, the workers brought barrels of wine. And one of them knocked down a barrel of wine, ceramic, and it's very big damage. You know, a bottle of wine today, let's see, this size, can be $20, right? So imagine a big barrel, it could be $1,000 or more. Especially back then, that it was much harder to make wine than today. Today you take 50 tons of grapes, and the machine comes, boom, it smashes everything. All the liquid comes down. There's all kinds of nets, screens, all the garbage. And you have beautiful grape juice, which later become wine. Back then, they had to have rubber boots manually. Step on the grapes for hours until you make one bottle of wine. Very difficult. That's why it was very expensive. So if you have a barrel of wine, it could be thousands of dollars like today. And the mover, the worker, knocked down the barrel. Well, he wasn't careful. So what did he do? He held his coat. Let's say he had a coat worth $200, whatever. He said, better take something than nothing. Anyway, he doesn't want to pay for the barrel. So the Chachamim called him and said, why don't you give him back his coat? He said, Dina Achi, what, I have to give him back the coat? He still owe me money. Made me a very big damage. So it's true, but someone in your level should not fall into such things. Somebody else, yes, but you big, important rabbi, you should do lifni mishurat adin. From holy people, Hashem expects to do more than what the halacha requires. Not only just, okay, that's the law, that's all I'm going to do. No, do a little more, nothing will happen. Okay, so we move on. So what's going on over here? So Uriah Hittite took her, and David HaMelech knows this is Shiduch. And Shlomo HaMelech supposed to come from this Shiduch. And Mashiach supposed to come from this Shiduch. Mashiach. If he doesn't get her back, there's not going to be Mashiach. The only reason David HaMelech was born in this world is courtesy of Adam. Adam HaRishon was supposed to die at age 1,000. And because Hashem told him, the day you eat from the tree, you'll die. And one day for Hashem, it's 1,000 years, like it's written in Tehillim. Kiyom be'enecha ke'elef, right? 1,000 years, one day. In a creation, you have 6,000 years, 1,000 for each day of the creation. That's why the world is 6,000 years. And the 7,000, it's days of Mashiach, meaning Shabbat. Spiritual 1,000. 1,000, meaning for the Shabbat day. 24 hours equal 1,000 years. So Adam HaRishon knew that the only way he can repent for his sin is that when Mashiach come. Because when Mashiach come, It's going to be all the wicked people will be cleaned from the world, Jews and non-Jews. Only righteous people will survive. And the people that died will resurrect. It will be the resurrection of the dead, meaning all the righteous people will come back to life. And the people will come from heaven into this world again, into a body, even though the soul could be for 2,000 years already in heaven without a body. Now Hashem puts the souls back in a body and send them back to the world. And that's an upgrade. It's not a downgrade. How can it be an upgrade if someone is in heaven enjoying the greatness of God and to put his soul again in a body, that's an upgrade? The answer, yes. If someone come now to the world before Mashiach come, that's a downgrade. That means you have to do a test again. If you're already a doctor, and one day the FBI come to you and say, listen, one of your tests was not, we found out it wasn't kosher. You cannot practice medicine. What are you talking about? You have to go for another semester and pass this test. That's a downgrade. Everybody understand. But if they send you back to school, and they say it's an upgrade, that means you're going to reach a higher level. How do you reach a higher level? Very simple. Because people will go back to the level of Adam HaRishon before the sin. When Adam was created, before the Yetzer Hara penetrated the body, that was the highest level. So now we're going back to this level of Adam before the sin. And that's why we say every day, Aleinu Leshabeach Letaken Olam B'Malchut Shaddai. That the world will be fixed, will be corrected back to the original setting. You have a phone, factory setting, full of problems, balagan, mess, music there, software doesn't work. One day you say, you know what, it's going to take me forever to fix this phone. Let's just start from fresh. Factory reset, brand new. Now you put everything new, updated. You work a little bit, but you fix it to the original level. Same thing over here. So because of that, Adam HaRishon gave David HaMelech 70 years donation. Because David HaMelech, he saw in his vision that's supposed to be a miscarriage. He doesn't have life on his own. So Adam HaRishon needed to contribute to give 70 years of his life. That's why he died age 930. Because 70 years he gave to David HaMelech, even though later he regretted it. Before he died, he wanted it back. Hashem said, deal is a deal. You gave it already. So David HaMelech knew that his whole purpose is to prepare Malchut Beit David, the Mashiach. And what a mistake I did. I gave to this low life the best Shiduch Bat Sheva. So what do I have to do? I have to send him to the war, hoping he's going to die. And then when he goes to the war, he has to give her a get. Right? Because the soldiers that go to the war, they may never come back. And not to keep their wives aguna, so they gave a get that when they come back, everything goes back to normal. But if they don't come back, then she has a get, she can go and get married. Okay. So, as results of that, he took her, she became pregnant, and the rest of the story is known. So this is the introduction to what's happening right now here. So, David HaMelech is 70 years old now. Gufo nichlash meod, his body is very weak. And he's freezing, shaking. He's very cold. Why is cold? Mida keneged mida. Measure for measure. Why Hashem didn't give him a different sickness? Why is freezing, shaking in bed? Nothing can keep him warm. Obviously, they had heat over there. They made fire, they put wood in the fire. Everyone is warm and he's freezing. What's going on? So, because when Shaul HaMelech was chasing him to kill him, while he was in a cave sleeping, David could have killed him. He didn't want to kill him. He knew he's righteous. He's just mistaken about me. He wants to kill me for nothing. So he cut his coat. He took his coat, the coat of the king, and he cut the corner of it. And later he said, you see, I was able to kill you and I didn't kill you. Look at you. You see, you were wondering who cut your coat. It was me. I could have slaughtered you and that would be the end of it. But I didn't do it. Meaning, you should appreciate it and leave me alone, right? So what's wrong with that? That's an act of heroism, no? It's a great human being, no? Yes, but by the way Hashem look at things, sometimes it's different than the way we. You did this and it's very nice that he didn't kill him, but this is the king of Israel. King deserves honor like you respect Hashem. You come, you cut his clothes. It's like act against the melucha, moret v'malchut. Mida keneged mida. You made a scene with clothes. Now clothes cannot keep you warm. So what do they need? He needs a woman to warm him up. Why? The only thing can warm a person when clothes doesn't help, it's body to body. Why? It's because everyone in a room always, the body always eject heat. I'll give you an example. Sometimes you come to a place, there's air condition. When you walk in as the first person into the room, it's freezing. Very cold. After 50 more people come into the room, 5 minutes later, you begin to sweat. Wow, what's going on? When I walked in, it was a freezer. Now it's very hot. The reason is because every person who comes into the body, into the room, his body eliminate 500 BTU from the air condition. So if you have 14,000 BTU air condition, how many people will eliminate it completely? 28 people. 28 people in a room, it's like the room is empty with no air condition. 28 people in a room with air condition, 14,000 BTU, it's a big piece. It's equal. So you see that every person has heat coming out of his body into the room. It's like every person is a heat. It's heating the room. It's very interesting. I see it in a shul. My house, we have a shul. I go there first one on Shabbat in the morning, and the AC is working, freezing. Then people starting to come. After an hour, I'm beginning to sweat. Why is it? The more people come in, the harder it gets. That's how it goes. So he's freezing, so they want to bring him a girl, Shunamit. Who is this girl? The sister of the Shunamit with Elisha. Remember the week before? Elisha went and there was the Shunamit. He gave her a blessing, all this story. She's her sister, Shunamit. What Shunamit? From the city of Shunam. There's a city called Shunam. Like you said, New Yorker. She's from Shunam. Okay. So they bring a very beautiful girl because it's the king, it has to be respectful. Okay, from here what do we learn? That beauty is important. Sometimes you hear, beauty is not it. Get married, she's righteous. Who cares about the beauty? The beauty is very important. I can show you 50 sources in the Torah that beauty is important, even in the eyes of Hashem. Even though it says, Sheker achen ve'evel ayofi, that many people destroy their own life because they were fascinated by the beauty of the woman and she destroyed them. And we can see it happens every second. That's only if they went only after beauty. And they ignore that she has horrible midot and terrible behaving and who knows what else. And no modesty and no nothing. No wisdom. And then they went and after the beauty, of course, Sheker achen ve'evel ayofi will destroy you. But if she has nice midot, and she's righteous and modest, and she's beautiful in your eyes, and then there's the same girl, modest, righteous, everything, but not beautiful in your eyes, who you must go after? The one that you like. 100%. And that's why it says in the Torah, Sarai is beautiful. Chava is the most beautiful woman ever lived. Because Hashem made her. She was not born from a woman. Meaning the artist made his greatest creation, it's Chava. Everything else is already genes and this, okay. Chava, okay. And then also, she has pretty eyes and she's pretty. The Torah keeps complimenting people about their beauty, women about their beauty. What do you see from here? That the beauty, it's important. Also Yosef, also by a man. Why the Torah has to tell us that Yosef was very handsome? There's a whole midrash that he was such a good-looking man, Yosef, that the fancy lady of Egypt, all the princesses and the rich ladies, friends of the wife of Potiphar, they gather together one day just to look at his beauty. When she calls him into the room, they all fainted, they cut their fingers with a knife. They were eating etrogim. The etrogim back then used to be very juicy. As they were cutting the etrogim, as soon as they saw how nice looking he is, they cut their finger off. When he was walking in Egypt, he was so modest, he was closing his eyes like this, not to look around. And the women, the Egyptian goyot, used to fall on the floor You know how the celebrities go and all these stupid people run and take 500 pictures. Leave us alone. They don't leave you alone. Okay, one, two, how many? 500 pictures. Same thing over here. There's no camera, so they just want to look at his face, but he was hiding himself like this. And they fall on the floor. Then he can step over them that they will be able to look in his face. All these midrashim about the beauty of Yosef. Why the Torah waste time to tell us about his looks? You see from here, the look of a person affects people. That's why in commercial they never choose ugly people. Did you ever see commercial that they bring someone that is disgusting to look at? Man or woman, did you ever see such thing? No, why? Because every fool knows beauty sell. Beauty affects people. You take a person that is not nice looking and a person that is nice looking, who has a much higher chance to sell the product? How they convince people to smoke all these things? They put all these signs, cigarette. All of a sudden, the cigarette became something good. Why? Because a nice looking person promoted, or coffee, or cars. What does it have to do with look? The car is good or not? By the way, it's not only by people like this. When you go to the auctions, almost everyone makes the same mistake. How people buy cars in the auction? They look at the cleanness of the car, the color, the shape. What about the engine, the transmission? This is what makes the car. What the beauty of the car? But most people, they buy based on a look. Why? Same thing fruits. They always put the nice fruit on top. And the rotten one in the bottom. Why? That it looks always nice. The idea is to present it in a nice way because it sells. So what happened over here? So they bring Avishag, she's young. David HaMelech obviously is unable anymore to act as a man. He's 7 years old, he's sick, shaking in bed. So as he's in bed for the last moments of his life, he has a son, Adonia. His mother named Chagit. In Israel, you have a lot of girls named Chagit. She raised him like Avshalom ben Ma'acha. Avshalom was also very bad. This Adonia is also not good. They never ever gave them hard words of Musar. American style. Hamudis, honey, how are you? Don't dare to yell at him, everything he wants, take mommy's credit card, call me if you need a ride. Serving him, they think, oh, I love my son, I give my life for him. Yeah. So what happened? After Avshalom died, with all the horrible story, he rebelled against his father, and David HaMelech suffered a lot from Avshalom. So Avshalom died, and Achitophel that gave him the bad advices also died. And now Adonia thought, since Avshalom is dead, Shlomo HaMelech is only 12 years old. He's only 12. Who deserves to be the king? Me! Right away, he got some of the leaders. Support me. Hello, how are you? If you support me, when I'll be the president, I'll make you chief of command. If you support me, I'll make you in charge of the money, the treasury. If you support me, I'll put you the head of the FBI. Already making calls before he became the king to get some of the rabbis and the leader to endorse him. And what do you think happened? What do you think? Everyone searched for the truth? No. Some people are always first, what's in it for me? That's why I always say for years. Not everyone who knows Torah cares about the truth. Some people first care about themselves, and if it works well with what Hashem wants, no problem, it doesn't affect me. But if there will be a contradiction between what Hashem say that it's right and what's good or bad for me, I come first. And you see it everywhere you go. Very rarely you find people that say, I'm sorry, that's the truth, and I don't move. I win. I lose. That's it. It's not relevant what's going to happen. That's the truth. I won't move an inch from the truth. No bribe, no jobs, no promises, no article in a newspaper, no threats. Nothing will help. That's what needs to be done. That's what will be done. That's it. And you have people like this. But not everyone. So, who right away ran after him. He made himself a nice carriage. He got the Bentley of Gorbachev. He's driving him around now like a man. Take me on a horse. Okay, so he made himself a carriage. And he thinks, I'm the king. That's it. It's reality now. I took control. My father is sick. He cannot fight me. There's nothing can be done now. 50 people on horses chasing him. Like, you know, he was like a nice group. Like the president with all these SUVs. And he got together with Yoav, the chief of command. So the head of the army is already on his staff. Eviatar HaKohen, also think about his future and his career, also important person, endorse him also. And David HaMelech now is paying the price for what mistake he made. What mistake? For never ever saying any Musar to him. They spoiled him and he never was strict with him. Never. Why Adonijah will have such a nerve? His father is dying and he make a party. You know a kid that will do such things. His father is in a hospital, he's still not dead, he makes a party. Mishte. Chaim, whiskey, wine, all the important people celebrating in the White House over there. What's going on here? And they announced him as the new king. Yechi HaMelech, everyone screaming, CNN, live broadcast, everything. Natan HaNavi, Natan the prophet, that is a real tzaddik, he said in the name of Hashem, Shlomo HaMelech, that's the one that will become the king after David. That's the plan of Hashem. Cannot be that this guy will be the king. He came to Bathsheba, the mother of Shlomo, and he said to her, come with me to David, that he should keep his promise. What was his promise? That Shlomo takes his place. He swore. So Nathan came with her, together, and he said, once you go in and speak to David, I will walk in. So what do we learn from here? That even if Nathan saw in a vision that Shlomo HaMelech will be the king, he still run and do ishtadlut. Why? Sit in home and drink l'chaim and count the minutes until Hashem will knock down this Adonijah and put Shlomo instead of him. No. In this world you have to do ishtadlut. Even Yaakov Avinu, Hashem promised him he will defend him, protect him. He went to the war with Esav with three different tactics. One, let's give him some bribe and gifts to calm him down. Let's separate to three different groups. If he attack from here, we'll attack. He comes with all kinds of tactics. Why? Hashem promised you, you will be defended. What are you so worried about? Come like this. Hi, Esav, you want to hurt me? Let's see you. No, let's see if you can move your finger. No. Even though he has a guarantee from Hashem, he was shaking. Why? You have to do ishtadlut. Plus, he thought maybe I made a scene. Maybe he took away from my merit. Okay. It's written right here, Velo atzavo aviv miyamav. His father never ever raised his voice at him. Why does it have to be written here? This is Kings Aleph, chapter 1. You know, Kings divided to two books, King 1 and King 2. So you go to the first book, first chapter, first verse. 1:1:1. Remember, very easy. Beginning of Kings. Aviv lo atzavo aviv miyamav. He never rebuked him. He never rebuked him. Lemor, madu akacha asita. Why did you do such a thing? Why did you do such a thing? Vegamu tov toar meod. He also very handsome. Charismatic, this Adonijah. What do we care about his look? It's important. ואותו ילדה, meaning raised, אחרי אבשלום, right? After אבשלום, that went in a very bad way, he is following the same bad way. So יואב בן צרויה, the head of the army, and אביתר הכהן, they're helping him out, and few other people. But who went to the side of David? צדוק הכהן, בניהו בן יהוידע, and נתן הנביא, right? ושימי וראי and some other heroes. They were stayed faithful to David. So, was Adonia religious or no? Or he became a goy? Was he off the derech or was still from? What do you think? Huh? Based on what I told you so far, does it sound like a from person? Huh? I'll show you things that from people do a lot worse than making a party before their father died. Trust me, a lot worse. You stick next to me 24 hours and see the stories who come to my ear every day. You won't believe you're living in this world, Bichlal. So Adonia is religious or not? He believes in Hashem or no? What do you think? I know what you think. Someone that behaves like this, you call him religious? Someone who goes to the theater in Manhattan, you call him religious? Sits there with a yarmulke. Someone who goes to baseball game for 4 hours, wasting his life and his children with all the goyim cursing over there, drinking beer and all these other words that comes out of their mouth. That's religious? There's a lot of questions that you can ask. Someone who keeps Shabbat and Motzei Shabbos got to smoke hookah in Astoria by the Greeks over there. Is religious? Religious woman from Bet Yaakov who walk with the tight jeans with holes on their knees. She's religious? Depends who you ask. People with a yarmulke size of a quarter. They're religious? Here, look. I even bought one. Inside the curls. You know? Look for it. You need an archaeologist to find it. Someone who voted Obama is religious? He has a very long beard. Someone who supports this dweck from England, give him donations every month, is religious or is a criminal? Or Casuto, the other clown. No, is religious? Do you see the new video from Casuto or no? He went to Target to take picture with Santa Claus and all the Christmas things in Target with his wife. Why you don't like Christianity? Really? Yes, watch the video. Someone told me that he's a Christian missionary a long time ago. But I thought it's just Lashon Hara, I didn't accept. Maybe. Now I'm beginning to see there is, after all, Yesh Dvarim Bego. Watch it. It's running around, that video. To the Chris Mouse department in Target, taking pictures with all the items of Santa. Maybe he needs a Santa Claus hat and to stand on the street and give some gifts. So who is religious? That's what, you can argue about every person almost. Almost about every person. So Adonia was religious or no? I'll read a verse for you here. ויזבח אדוניהו צאן ובקר ומרי. מה זה מרי? What's מרי? צאן ובקר, you know what it is, right? צאן, cattle, בקר, the cows. And מרי. Don't worry, don't feel bad that you don't know this word because I make a bet with you. Take a million Israelis from the university. If one of them will know the meaning of the word Mary, I'll give you $100 for everyone. How am I so generous? I'm not. I just know nobody knows this word. What's the meaning of this word? Shor mefutam, fat ox. Which meat is more delicious, cow or ox? Huh? You want to make a steak now. Better from the ox or better from the cow? Cow is softer. Ox is very hard. Ox is harder. But this is... ox is very, very fat, like a hippo. So there's so much fat, so it's very good. So he made sacrifices to Hashem. So he's religious or not? Pray, mincha, shachrit, arvit. Very good, no? Ay, 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 ay. So of course they come, they complain to David HaMelech. And they say he's making a party, everyone eating and drinking and screaming, Yechi HaMelech, Yechi Adonenu, they scream, right? Murenu v'Rabenu. And li, and to me, and to Tzadok HaKohen, and to Benayahu Ben Yehoyada, and to Shlomo, he did not call. He made sure none of us will participate in that party. Why? Because he's hiding it. That he's becoming now the king on his own decision. Is it something that you instructed your majesty? Because you never told me. Vayan David HaMelech, David answered, called Bathsheba. She stood in front of the king. Vayishava HaMelech, he swore, Chai Hashem, on the life of Hashem, that redeem my soul from all trouble, that I swear in the name of the God of Israel, that I swore to you before, that your son Shlomo will inherit my chair and will be the king after me. She bowed down twice, Yechi Adoni HaMelech David Le'olam. That's it. That's the story. So King Shlomo became the king. And you know right away the story, right? That two women fought for a baby. It's my baby, not baby. Say, cut the baby in the middle. You know, first of all, I want to ask you a question. That's what made his reputation very famous. 12 years old, look how clever he is. I'm asking you, between me and you, is that a clever advice or not? What's so clever about it? What would happen if the real mother, first of all, when you have the real mother of the baby, and you have the other one, and the other one knows it's not her baby, she's about to kidnap a baby from the real mother, because her own baby died. So now, if she is such a snake, and so evil, to do such thing, all she needs is to go on with her show one more step further, to say, no, okay, I don't want you to kill my baby. Give it to her. It's not her baby. To put the show. Right? What woman will actually turn herself in by saying, okay, cut him. Give me half and give her half. Plus, if we would stand in front of a king and he say, bring us a sword, let's cut the baby to two. We'll give her half and we'll give him half. We would believe him, Bechlan? What king will do such thing? Even Saddam Hussein wouldn't do this. Huh? He would cut the baby to two. You take the head, you take the legs. Huh? What do you think? So what's so clever about it that the whole world was shaking? Huh? You know what the problem is with us? We hear, but we never actually dig deep to understand what's going on here. That's why almost none of the stories in the Torah we understand correctly. We think Esav was with tattoo, ponytail, like this, walking. Hey, what's up? You really think that? The story of the Torah is so deep that without the real serious commentaries that you have to read for hours and hours and hours, you don't understand anything. And you know what? Even after you read so much, you still don't understand a lot. You understand something, but it's very complicated. The Torah is not just a story like a movie. You read the details, you understand the script. I want to read to you something interesting. Chazal say, while Avshalom was fighting David, Avshalom was fighting David, rebel against his father. Do you know today a son that hates his father so much? Let's find a person that hates his father more than words can describe. Will he take his wife and have relation with her? Oh, that would be already, okay, come on, I hate him so much, but I won't do such thing. Would you know anyone, Rasha, Merusha, among the Goyim, I don't know, Arabs, Christians, anyone, that will dare to do such thing? I highly doubt it. Take the most wicked people, that's my stepmother, come on, right? Avshalom took all the wives of David, all of them, one after the other. Unbelievable. And who gave him this advice? Who gave him the advice? The chief rabbi of Israel. The chief rabbi of Israel. Achitofel. He knows all the Torah in reverse. Not from right to left. From left to right. You know who was Achitofel? Why does the Torah tell us such a horrible story? That the biggest, the most knowledgeable person in Torah was the biggest evil, rotten monster on earth that ended up committing suicide. That was his end. He committed suicide when his plan fell. But why does the Torah have to tell us such an ugly story? Come on, make it prettier. Why you give us such an ugly story in a movie? Sometimes they ruin the movie. They put 5 bad minutes in a movie. The rating went down by 80%. Why? Ruined the whole movie. Over here, that's really what happened. But why do you have to bring it? To teach you that knowing a lot of Torah is very important and it's an obligation of every man. But that's not a guarantee that you will be a human being. If you're a dirty politician and you have rotten ideology, and you are influenced by university and all kinds of places you visited, or the internet, or all kinds of rotten books you read, everything becomes a salad in your head. So even though I will ask you every question about every halakha in Shulchan Aruch, you will know each halakha by heart and exactly where it is. And you're still worse than a regular goy walking on the street that never opened one page of Torah in his life, in the eyes of Hashem. Because from this goy, Hashem doesn't expect anything. He's not supposed to learn Torah. Well, he's supposed to learn Torah. He was born in Mexico. What do you want from him? He doesn't know Torah. He's taking care of the horses, the donkeys, and the mountains of Mexico over there. What does he know from Torah? You have any expectation from him? Is he a guilty person? Is he a criminal? No. That's the way he was raised. Someone all his life into the Torah. He knows everything about Hashem and became such a monster, a murderer, saying such things, taking pictures with Santa Claus things in a Christian department in Target. Can you find a bigger filth than this? And growing a beard like this, misleading people to think that he's a rabbi, that they'll fall into his hand and they get destroyed in Olam Haba. This is what we're talking here about. Someone that come with earring and ponytail and tattoos and jeans with holes and a leather jacket is not a threat. Because every stupid Jew knows to run away from him. That's not where I grew up. Someone that comes with his custom and say all kinds of words of Torah, but his mind is all corrupted with garbage and dirt and who knows what else. That's the biggest danger. And that's what the Torah wants to teach. Achitofel. The Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin bring a list of people who knew Torah more than all the rabbis in the world combined. And the Gemara speaks very strong Lashon Hara against them. They have no share to the world to come. Why? Greed. Bad midot. Their bad midot destroyed these people. And this is one of them. So Avshalom, fighting his father David, there was one tzaddik, Hushai Aarki. He said, why did something like this happen? Because David HaMelech married a beautiful Goya, converted her in a war, Eshet Yifat Toar. Even though the Torah allowed to take her, because, you know, we have a whole parasha about it. But we know one thing, and David should have known it. Kol ha-noseh yifat toar, everyone who go after a goya for her beauty and convert her, like so many thousands of our brothers out there, סופו להוליד בין סורר ומורה. It's just a matter of time until a horrible kid will come out of this marriage and will drink his blood with a straw for breakfast. Meaning, will destroy him. Why is it? Gemara, Masechet Sanhedrin, not me. I don't bring my own opinions here. Sanhedrin, Kuf Zayin, 107. לפיכך נולד לו אף שלום. Here you go. אדוניהו also was born מאשת יפת תואר. Twice the same thing. מאחה and חגית. And what do you think? They didn't keep mitzvot? מאחה and חגית after David converted them? Of course they did. They married to the chief rabbi of Israel. They won't keep mitzvot? You understand? David did not want to rebuke him for his bad actions because he knew that Adonijah will answer him, Dad, it's all your fault. You married my mother and I was born and I have no free choice. I have to be bad. The Torah said that if you marry Eshet Yifat Torah, you're going to have a son that will destroy you. What do you want from me? It's not in my hand. Already David know I caused it. I don't have the power to rebuke him. You understand? Sometimes it happens by parents. You're very tough to your son. You're violent with him, give him punishments, you not everything, not allowed. You're calling him names, Rasha, this. What happened? He's full of anger inside, that wants to rebel, but he's still young. Doesn't have the strength and the courage to rebel. But one day when he becomes 16, 17, he begins a massive war against his father, and it turns very ugly, and it happens to thousands of people in this generation. And all the anger that they accumulated over the years, now in one shot comes out, and it's a disaster. 911, police, drugs, stealing, come get your son, come do all these things that happens to people. And the parents, the father, I mean, he cannot really do anything now to save the situation because in his mind, I caused it. You understand? Every week you're going to come later and later. Huh? Very nice.
You remember the time has come. Okay.
Very nice, very
nice. You know what?
Next time I come, let me do it on time. What was it today? The lawyer? Conversation? What?
We're on the record.
So you understand what's going on here? And same thing over here. So he said, I'm anus. Leave me alone. You caused it. Like in America, every kid that has a problem, what do they say? Leave him alone. He was abused when he was a child. Although sometimes it's true. Some kids were abused, unfortunately. Many of them were not abused. They actually had life of kings. Their life was so pleasant and pleasure, and they were so spoiled that sometimes you think, I wish they were abused a little bit. I would save them. Their life was too good. That's why they became like that. Not the other way around. Because almost every person was abused by someone. This guy bully you in school, this teacher make your life be there, you know, all kinds of events in life. Sometimes you have two brothers, they both had a tough father, one turned out good, one turned very bad. They both have the same abuse. So what do you see? Even with all of that, one can be better than the other if he really wants. In the old days it was even harder, because today parents already learn a lot. That the hard way doesn't work. But in the old days, let's say 40, 50 years ago, when people were more primitive and more violent, the nightmare that people used to have when they were kids was much worse than now. Because today there is an awareness for it. Plus today people complain to the police and the authorities do something about it. But in the old days, if you call the police 50 years ago, my father just smacked me, he said, very good. Should smack you 5 more times. Well, the police wouldn't understand what you want from him. Today, he called, oh, my father just hit me. Stay still right there. We're on the way. We send the We send a car. Take the father, put handcuffs. It's a whole different world today. Did it become any better? Not really. The Gemara says in Baba Batra, page 15, there is a say. You say to someone, Tol kesam ben enecha. Kesam, it's like a toothpick. Take it from in between your eyes. It's an expression. And the person answer, Tol kora mi ben enecha. There's a big stick. What's smaller? A toothpick or a big stick? A big stick, right? So you come to say to a person, you have a little problem, fix it. Right the way he answer you with an attack. You have a much bigger problem. You should fix it first before you rebuke me. Right? So then it's very difficult to rebuke people. I once went to a place to pray shachrit. I saw one old guy, angry face like this. His tefillin is to the other side. And then the other tefillin is almost on his nose already. I say, Chaval, this old man come to shul, puts tefillin, and he's not putting it in the right place. It doesn't count. So I go like this to him. Can't talk now. He's tefillah. He goes like this. He says, show him tefillin. There's such a lure. Oh, one more mess. He's going to take a gun and shoot. Then after, I came nicely to him. You know, the tefillin has to be towards the heart. Looks at me like this, mind your own business. What's the problem? Someone tried to help you out. The ego. You're half of my age, you're telling me what to do. Meaning, ma, I'm so dumb that I couldn't know it on my own. I'm double than your age. So it's the ego. But if he was humble, what would he say? Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you very much for telling me. No one ever told me. Isn't it a shame? Couldn't I meet you 20 years earlier? At least I would do it right. But depend on how humble is the person. Tol korami ben enecha. Meaning, you come to help him out with something small, he attacks you on something big. That's why a person does not have the strength to fix other people's action before he fixed himself. You understand? It's like a glass of water that you pour water into it, right? It's empty. You fill it up. Now, if it's only half full, up to here, once it comes to the top and it begins to spill out, then you can fill up another cup. Put a cup underneath. After you already fixed, you're all the way to the top. Then from your leftover, meaning what comes out, you can affect the people. But if you yourself are incomplete, it's very difficult to help other people. Even mentally, you don't have the strength. Because while you're talking to them, you know that you yourself has this problem. So naturally, it's affecting your power of speech. You don't speak with confidence. That's why it doesn't work. But if you know yourself, you're very clean about it, then it's working. Dvarim hayotzim min halev, nichnasim el halev. Why David, there's another reason, why David did not rebuke Adonijah. One other reason. Because David had a rule in his life. What is it? Personal example. Dugma ishit. You want your kids to love Torah? Show them how much the Torah is important, how you give your life for the Torah. Then they see you, and they like to be like this also, because kids want to imitate their parents. So David say, if I'll be perfect, I don't have to preach to my kids. They'll learn from me. He did not see any need to rebuke him. Is it true today to our life? If you're going to be perfect, does it mean your kids will be perfect or no? Totally not. Why? I'll give you an example. Let's say you do not touch sport. Nothing. No baseball, no football, no basketball. You're very against it. Now you send your children to the best yeshiva in town. This Litvish yeshiva. They teach Gemara all day. They're very serious rabbani. They're very makpid, very yekish. Half of the kids, they're addicted to sport. Every player in the league, they'll tell you his grandmother's name and date of birth. They know the names of these athletes from Africa more than they know about the rabbanim. Everything he knows, how much his statistic, how much he makes. So the father has no idea about baseball or football. What does he know about this? You send him to a good yeshiva, pay $20,000 a year tuition, and what does he come? Your son became Mr. Jackson, all day in the house. Why not like that? You see the father like this all day. And you see Mr. Jackson goes like this. Who is he imitating? So what happened to Dugma Ishit? Many wives are very modest. Very modest. How their daughters come out? They want to dress like models on the street signs. They look at some other bad things, not tzanua on the street. The mother gives her life for tzniut. She doesn't even want to wear a skirt. How many parents like this come to me every week? Talk to him, talk to her, talk to him. And you wonder. You see some rabbanim, avrechim, all day in the Torah. Their life is a Torah. They don't even have smartphone, nothing. And what happened with the kids? Only nonsense in their head. And all the nonsense from the streets. Why? Because today it's not enough dugma ishit. Because the kids most of the time are not in the house. They're on the streets or in a school. So if the school would teach them certain things you don't want, there's nothing you can do about it. What are you going to do? Don't send them to school? So they won't know alphabet. They won't know how to learn Gemara. They won't know halakha. What are you going to do? You understand how the Satan grabs us from everywhere, whatever we do, he penetrated everywhere, even to the greatest yeshivot. There's nothing you can do. And when you ask the rabbis, what's going on here? Believe me, you don't know what's going on in this world. Believe it's better he's going to be busy with this than the other things that we have to worry about. And he also writes, it's a catch-22. You know this situation that you know the other person is right just as much as you are? Nothing you can do. This is what the Torah says, "Vayita meshuga mimarei enecha." This is the curse that we have today. Become crazy from what you see. "Vayita meshuga mimarei enecha." Nothing you can do. "Bnotecha netunot la'am acher." Your daughters are going with other stranger nation, meaning goyim, like the 60,000 Israelis with Arabs in the villages in Israel. Such a disaster. Hundreds of thousands of Jews grew up like Arab Muslims. Some of them in a Hamas, jihad, killing Israelis, killing their own brothers and cousins to prove to the Muslim, we are just as good murderers like you. Because they call them Yahud. So they try to prove they're not Yahud. Sad, sad what's happening here. One guy spoke few days ago in Israeli Knesset, it's not religious, it's secular, but he has a heart relates to Jewish subjects. I gave a speech. I sent it to some people, his speech. His name is Oren Chazan. He gave a speech that one Chabadnik in Tel Aviv put tefillin on people's. So he called the person, excuse me, would you like to put tefillin? They gave him a ticket for harassment. I don't know if the harassment is the right word, but illegal activity, let's call it that way. In Israel!
Jewish state.
So what happened? This guy in the Knesset, he gave a speech to all the liberal lefties. And he said, you're complaining about anti-Semitism? What they did to the Jews in Europe, or what they want to do to the Jews now, today, in these days, when half of these people in this country are worse anti-Semites than them, you give a ticket in the land of the Jews to a Chabadnik that offer another Jew, would you like to put tefillin? What's the big deal? He can say, no, I don't like. What happened? Nobody can offer anything anymore. You walk in the street, somebody gives you a flyer. 50% off. Ticket. Right? Ticket for what? I offered you, maybe I save you money, maybe you get a nice suit. You don't want, put it in the garbage, man. Nobody, you don't owe me anything. You can say, no, thank you.
But the Arabs can put their...
So he said, she's the first one I send everything. She told me that I couldn't function all day from anger. It's really very upsetting. So he said, when every Arab here in this country open his mouth in the middle of the street, in the middle of offices, everywhere, and prayed to God, not of these lefties, liberals, ever say a word, and it's good. We respect everybody. Other religions as well. No problem, freedom. In this country, a freedom of religion. Only when it comes to Judaism, no freedom. But you see, everyone was busy with his speech, which was very impressive. I was also busy looking at the guy who runs the show, sitting next to him. He was dying. Watch it again. See his body language. He was dying to block his mouth. Another liberal. Okay, he said. Okay, finish. You had to see how the other Jew that was sitting running the committee, how he was dying instead of going like this. Yeah, he's right. He was dying, but when will he finish his speech? Right? And they go crazy. They hate religion so much. So he told them, many of you liberals already forgot what does it mean to be a Jew. It's time you wake up and be proud of your religion, because everything they have, they learned from us. And they are, don't forget, there's 14 Arab terrorists sitting right there. What kind of a government we have? It looks like a circus. 14 Arab jihadist terrorist Hamas sitting in the Knesset, getting paid by the Israeli to speak their Muslim agenda to destroy Israel. Sitting in the government. Another 40, 50 liberal lefties, pro-gay, pro-everything that is anti-Torah, with horrible ideology. Half of the government is enemies of Israel and God. Think about it. And then the other ones, few Russians, communists, also anti-religion, and another party of 20 members who the entire agenda is hate to religion. Think about it. So you wonder to yourself, from 120 people, maybe you have 40 people who have a little bit respect to religion. Few religious ones, and that's it. That's the government we have today. So personal example is very, very important. You know, in this parasha we learn about the power of prayer. From who? Who teach us the power of prayers? I have one lecture that I gave in a seminar of Keraftuni. Depend who you are, how you say it. Keraftuni or Keraftanu. The secrets of the prayers. It's a very good lecture. Sometimes the lecture comes out perfect. A speaker knows by the time he finished the lecture, he knows if Hashem was with him or not. You feel. That morning, it was Mamash Hashem speaking. Sometimes, like last night, you don't feel it. It happens. It depends on thousands of things. Depends on you, depends on the crowd, depends on the place, depends on the date. Depends on many things. Who has the schut, who doesn't have the schut. Sometimes for one person in the audience, Hashem gives you the speech of your life. Not for you, for him or for her. And how many thousands of times it happens that after the lecture, people came to me, "Wow, you don't know what you just did to me. I was about to do this, I was about to do that." I gave a lecture against Las Vegas. I got an email from a guy, "You don't know how you just saved me. I was about to go and open a bakery in Las Vegas. Everything is ready. I didn't know it's so bad over there." A Jewish family just got saved. They leave Israel, religious, go over there, Las Vegas. What is the chance they'll stay religious like they are in Yerushalayim now? Sometimes 5 minutes in a speech saves the life of so many people. It's mamash hard to believe. Yesterday I got an email from a woman from Israel. She actually was born in Israel. She came to America when she was 5. She grew up American. And when she got 40, 42 or something like that, she went to Israel. Now she's 4 years in Israel. She lives there. She said that when she was 17, 18, she discovered religion. She started to learn and became Shomer Shabbat by 18. And until a year ago, she always considered herself religious. Until she has a friend from Australia that sent her a link to one of my lectures. What was the lecture? Time to wake up from our illusions or something like that. You know, one of those fire lectures. She said to me, every day of my life I think, what would have happened if I missed that email that changed my entire life? Totally. I started to listen to the lectures and I just realized how not religious I am. Even though I'm Shomer Shabbat, eating kosher. I just realized how far I was from Hashem and from religion. And what she became now is a whole different story. This is all her description. So what do you see? A person can think, I'm religious, I'm living according to Hashem rules, and one day to get a punch to his face, religious? You're lucky if you can even be called traditional. For the examples I gave you before. You think I'm joking when I say that someone that vote Obama can never be called religious? Or Hillary? Do you think I'm joking? I'm 1,000,000,000% serious and I'm 1,000,000,000% right. And you wait and see what punishment these people will get when they stand in front of Hashem, calling themselves religious. Because as soon as they die and they will have a trial, Hashem will show them how much he did for gay marriage. And that will be their end. With all the religion. That's alone. We're not talking about Iran and the Muslims and what he did against Israel. I'm not even talking about all of that. Just this alone. That's it. You see what happened in Iran? Do you know how many earthquakes they had since the Muslim took over? They didn't have so many in the times of the Shah. They had earthquakes that tens of thousands of people died. Today it's minor compared to the ones they already had. Tens of thousands of people die in one earthquake. In the past in Iran, I checked today the history, about 7 earthquakes. Thousands of dead all the time. Today, it's the second most minor earthquake. And look what a disaster. Hundreds of people die, thousands are wounded. Every time they start with Israel, boom, Hashem does something. They once made a film that every time George Bush, the father, or Bill Clinton, or Obama were forcing Israel to give up something to the Arabs, a natural disaster happened in this country. One guy made that film. One guy, American. This is what we did to Israel. This is what God did to us. This is what we did to Israel. This is what God did to us. I recommend that. You have to watch this film. Show dates, details. Amazing film he made. Goy. Not a rabbi. If a rabbi would make it, what would happen to him the next day in the internet? Who does he think he is? He's a speaker of God? You read God's mind? No. But we know one thing. What the Torah say? Hashem told us how he thinks and how he reacts. Everything I do is midah keneged midah. Measure for measure. And I don't ever make people suffer unless they deserve it. Two rules. That's it. What do you need to be a genius? Two rules. I get punished. I suffer. It means equal I'm guilty of something. I don't know what. So I have many, many things. Maybe it's Shabbat, maybe it's Tefillin, maybe it's Tefillah, maybe it's modesty, maybe it's kosher food, maybe it's Lashon Hara, maybe, 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 maybe until tomorrow. So what do I do? One punch to the face, 50 fixings I did. I don't need 50 punches. One, with a question mark. Maybe it's for Lashon Hara, let's fix it. Maybe it's for Shabbat, let's fix it. Maybe it's for modesty, let's fix it. Maybe it's for kosher food, let's fix it. So I can fix 50 problems with one punishment. But one thing for sure, if somebody's sick, or loses money, or die, or anything that you can think of, that means he deserved it, maybe from previous life, maybe from 3 lives ago. But for sure he deserved it, and that's one of the 13 principles of Judaism. Anyone that say that he didn't deserve it, does not deserve to be called a Jew. Because to be a Jew, you have to keep the 13 principles of Judaism. Judaism has 13 principles. It's a building that stands on 13 poles. 13 poles. If you take one pole down, the building falls. 12 cannot hold a big building. 13. Take one down, 2 months later, the building collapsed. The weight was too much for the other 12. If there are some of the principles you deny or debate, you don't deserve to be called a Jew. Check yourself. Because to be a Jew, you have to accept the 13 principles of Judaism. And that's the first thing they tell the converts. You want to convert? What are the 13 principles of Judaism by heart? I'm not sure. I don't know. Come back in 3 weeks. 4 weeks. Go, practice, come back. They're not going to convert him. If it's a kosher Beit Din, he doesn't know the 13 principles, wants to be a Jew. But I don't get one thing. 90% of the Jews don't know the 13 principles. They take advantage. They were born Jewish. But by Hashem, it's not only who is your mother. Do you deserve to be called a Jew? Yes or no? Well, I gave an example. To be a Jew, you need 2 major conditions. One is that your mother is Jewish. And second, that you keep Shabbat. If you don't have one of the 2, you damage your Judaism foundation and you don't deserve to be called a Jew. If your mother is not Jewish, for sure you're not a Jew. If your mother is Jewish, but you are Mechalel Shabbat, it's written in a Jewish book of law that you are a goy. Mechalel Shabbat, areu kegoy lechol davar. And I did not write Shulchan Aruch. I already told you that in the past, but maybe you forgot. I did not write the Shulchan Aruch. I wasn't alive then. Nobody asked me in my previous life, to the best of my knowledge. I don't know, maybe I did write Shulchan Aruch. probably it wasn't me. But nobody ever consulted with me who deserved to be a Jew and who deserved to get what punishment. Knowing myself, I will be very easygoing. Hashem, come on. You're too tough with this guy. Too tough with this. Too tough. Let go. Let go here. Cut here. 50% off. Why? It's hard as it is. But nobody asked me. 500 years. Almost 500 years.
What are the 3 rabbis who are used to make a ruling there?
The 3 major rabbis that the Shulchan Aruch is based on is the Rif, Rabbi Alfasi, he lived in Morocco about 900 years ago. The Rambam, that was in Spain and later went to Egypt. And the Rosh, Rabbeinu Asher. 2 Sfaradim, 1 Ashkenazi.
Rosh, how old is it?
Rosh is about almost 800 years.
So all of them like 800 years. So actually, Shulchan Aruch is 800 years ruling. Even if it's a 500 years.
100%. It's 2 against 1. Ruling.
I understand that at that time the Jews lived a different life.
Yeah.
It was a community.
Yeah.
They didn't live with the Goyim.
No, they live with the Goyim. The Gemara full of examples that the Goyim come to Bet Merchat.
Huh? They were separate. They were separated. They lived by the community.
No. They lived in close neighborhood. Like today, you go to Monsi, it's all Jews. but you still see goyim, the cleaning people, this driver, goyim comes and go, they come to Motsi, sell merchandise.
Motsi is a very good example. That's what I meant.
There's not one close neighborhood today completely that you don't have goyim coming in. There's no such thing in the world. Not in Israel, not in America, and nowhere in the world.
Uh-huh.
Even in Monroe, that is the most strict, satmer, ultra, ultra, ultra fanatic extreme, plenty of goyim there. Cleaning lady, drivers, school buses, police, fire department. 1,000 goyim every day walks by.
But it was even more tough. At that time, it was less goyim among the Jewish communities.
From the Gemara, you see that the market where they used to sell merchandise had a lot of goyim. In the mikveh, the bet mirchatz, there was public showers. There were goyim, Arabs all the time. There were Arab black magician living among them also, because the Gemara described that he lives nearby. So, you know, it's too hard to generalize. One thing for sure, goyim were always around Jews. One thing I can tell you, that no matter where the Jews went to live, the Arabs followed them. Always.
I'm trying to say that, what I was trying to say is that 800 years, somebody from Mechalel Shabbat was like this goy. Because what are you doing among us? What kind of Jew you are?
Yes.
That's why. It's like today, you're going to become, I don't know, if you're going to say I'm a Jew, but I'm going to mosque every year. For the big holiday, you can say, what kind of Jew you are? You don't go to shul, but you go to the mess. The same thing was there. So that's what I'm trying to...
Okay, I tell you what. The foundation of Judaism, the Jews has a purpose in life. The purpose of the Jews is to teach the world about God. Or la goyim. And the way that when we keep Shabbat, the goyim come and ask the Jew, why you don't work today? Why you don't light fire? Why you don't ride on a donkey? Why you do all these strange things? So the Jew explained to the goy, listen, Tony, God created the world in 6 days. Don't give me this laugh. And then in the 7th day he rested. Then Tony began to ask, really? I heard in college that the world is billions of years old and it was made by itself. Come on, Tony, use your head. Do you know anything that was made by itself? You're right. I think actually it doesn't make sense. So why you believe the professor when you went to university? You're right. He fooled me. I even paid for their books. So here you go. Tony now go to his father, Vinny. Dad, I met this Jew today. And they're very, you know, they're different than us. They don't do this. You know why they don't do it? Because God made the world in 6 days. Oh, yeah, sure, he's right. So then you teach the world about Hashem. So if the Jew doesn't keep Shabbat and behave like a goy, he defeats his own purpose. You understand? That's why he's not considered a Jew. You know what? I tell you one thing, and we finish the arguments
why, one for all. Why are we talking about Shulchan Aruch only? It's about Ten Commandments as well.
Ten Commandments, Gemara, which is 2,000 years ago. But let's finish the arguments one for all. If you know that the most important person in the world said in a close conversation that if he could, he would kill you. You don't deserve to live. But he didn't do anything against you. Still free. You still make business. But you know that the most important person in the world says such a thing about you. Would it make you feel horrible? Yes or no? The greatest person, if you're a Christian, if the Pope would say, this guy Tony from New York doesn't deserve to breathe. It will be the end of his life. He's a Christian believer. Wow, the Pope says such thing about me. I better go to Italy over there. Let's take care of business. No, it would drive him crazy. If Rav Ovadia Yosef would come in public and speak against someone and say, Rasha, Merusha, Pikores, that, you know, it's mitzvah to put him down. That's it. This guy's finished forever and ever. Even 1,000 years from now, no one will ever forget that. Even when we're going to die and our children and grandchildren, they're always going to know from tradition that there was the head rabbi in the world and he's saying his speech about this person that is totally wicked and faker, which he did once in his life against one person. That's it. That person is finished. No matter what he's going to do, he never come out of the grave. Not in this world, not in the next world. Even though he's still walking, still making money, you know, still have some good things about his life. But he knows inside that moment, my life is over. So if you read in the Torah that God say that someone like you that is breaking Shabbat do not deserve to live. You deserve to get rocks like this in the size of a melon and people throw it on your head and blow your head out. Even though no one will ever do it to you. Not just because we don't have Sanhedrin today and we don't have Bet HaMikdash and there's no execution. Even when there was Sanhedrin and when there was Bet HaMikdash, rarely ever they executed one person in whole history. So the rabbis did not rush to execute anyone. They will do everything they can to let them go with a doubt. We found a contradiction between the witnesses. You can go. So it's not about, oh, they'll kill me or they won't kill me. They will never kill me. But this is what God thinks about me. If you're smart, you won't stop crying for years. Immediately you become Shomer Shabbat. Forget about the old days, the new days. There is Sanhedrin. It's not relevant. No one will die. No one will be executed in this world. God will take care of all the wicked people when the time comes. But this is what God thinks about me. I remember, I'll never forget this moment. 40 minutes I spoke to him. In a learning program, one Persian guy was his friend. He called me in advance, I need you to come to the learning program in Great Neck today. I said, listen, the learning program is not for me. There's Baruch Hashem, a lot of rabbis, they teach around the table. I have to reserve my time for lectures. No, no, it's very important. I have a great friend. He doesn't know a lot. He grew up here. He didn't go to yeshiva. He has very good heart. Come, speak to him. One-on-one, please. Okay, I'm coming. I went to that place. 40 minutes I spoke to him. All I did, believe me, no proofs, no Torah and science material, nothing. All I did is read to him a few verses in the Torah among the Mechalel Shabbat. He had long hair like this, handsome boy, from a wealthy family, sport car, lived the American dream. He started to cry. The whole chumash, it's like you spill this puddle of water all over. That's how the chumash was wet. He started to cry. Ez rasha, he speaks Hebrew. Ez rasha, I didn't know I'm such a rasha. I didn't know that's what Hashem thinks about me. Immediately became Baal Tshuva. Married religious girl. Religious until today. And made his whole family wake up. And what did we find? That his grandfather was a Vishnitz Hasid in Monsi, lived by the Rebbe from Vishnitz. He went and knocked on his door. Psh, he came to my house one day, his grandfather, to thank me for this. Last time he saw him was probably in his brit. 40 minutes, only few verses. How much you can do in 40 minutes? That's it. He read few verses from the Torah, what Hashem thinks about Mechalel Shabbat. He never ever broke Shabbat again. Imagine if all the Jews would be like this, pure. That's it. In 1 week, I make all of them religious and finished. But they won't be. It's a hard struggle. That's called the bonus that Hashem gives you in your career. Your work, you sweat a lot on all the stubborn people and all the foolish people and all the arrogant people, all the Erev Rav and the liberals and the lefties and the Torah haters and all the evil people. And then once in a while, you get a candy. Tak, ta, 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 1, 2, 3. Save neshama, kids, grandchildren. Bli ayin hara. Do you understand what I'm saying? Here and there you have. I had another guy like this. Amos Efroni, kibbutznik. From the kibbutz, kibbutz Bet HaShita. He was managing Little Neck Car Wash on Northern Boulevard. On the way to Great Neck, on the right side. Little Neck Car Wash. There was all the black people from Africa working there, and he was in charge of them in a shift. You know, I go there, I wash my car. How long does it take for the car to go in and out? 7 minutes. The car goes in, he comes out, all the Africans drying the car, and there was two Israelis. The Israeli owned the car, so he bring Israeli from the army, that can supervise. So I didn't even speak to him. He was standing nearby. I spoke to the other Israeli that I knew him from seeing him one time before. How are you? How are you doing? And I said to him, maybe you come to my lecture. I speak tonight about life after death. No, I'm working here until midnight. It's a night shift. Then this kibbutznik, he came to me. Come on, you really believe there's such thing, life after death? Anyone came back from there? I say, millions came back from there. Well, how come we never heard? I say, if you come to my lecture, you will hear some proofs there's life after death. Come on, I don't believe that someone like you would believe such thing. That you really believe the such thing? I say, no, I don't believe. So how do you speak about something you yourself don't believe? I say, I don't believe. I know 1,000,000%. Nobody came from there. How do you know? I say, yes, yes. Come to the lecture. No, I can. I walk with him until midnight. I already saw he's showing interest. But I didn't know yet what kind of neshama this Jew has. I had a book, Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just. That's one of the reasons I decided to make a series about it. After I saw the impact of the book in such a kibbutznik, total ignorant in Judaism. He didn't even know who Noach was. Never heard of Noach in his life. This is in Israel, in a kibbutz. Even in Russia, they teach about Noach, Vladimir and his friends. So what happened? I gave him the book, Mesilat Yesharim. 2 or 3 days later, he called me up, gave him my card. He said to me, listen, I live in Manhattan in 1st Avenue and 92nd Street by the car wash. There used to be car wash over there. Now they sold it, it became a building. It used to be a car wash, very busy car wash. 1st Avenue and 92nd Street. There's a building, 4 floors over there. All the Israelis from the kibbutz live there. Because the owner of all the car wash is Israeli, owned that building, and he let the kibbutznikim live there. You don't know what they're doing to me that I'm reading this book. 3 days I'm fighting with them. I need you to come. Can you come speak to all my friends? I felt like I won the lottery. Yes, of course. We made a date. I went there. I come to a small room, small apartments, you know, Manhattan. Maybe 30 guys and girls. Purple walls, purple, dark purple walls, you know? Imagine the atmosphere in a room. All of them smoke drugs. I couldn't see their faces. All I saw is smoke. I became dizzy already. And on top of it, they had these birds. You know these birds who fly and whistle nonstop in a room? They fly in a room. And there's not enough chairs. So they sit one on the other, one on top of the other. And I spoke there who knows how many hours. Who knows? I can't even tell you. 3, 4. We're talking at least 15 years ago, something like that. And you had to see that show. I wish that lecture was filmed. I'm telling you, it would be, no one would ever believe such thing. For hours, if scream, the women began to cry, Amos, al tazov otano. It's like we're taking him to Auschwitz or something. Don't leave us, please, you're my best friend. They don't even care what I speak. They don't even listen. Then he got up. That was a moment. He couldn't take it anymore. He said, you know what? And you know, they're all like intelligent. Intelligent from the kibbutz. He got up. He said to them, I just realized how my whole life was all a lie. Until today, I was so proud that all of you are my friends and I have so many friends. I felt so lucky and now I'm so disgusted from you. I can't even look at you anymore. The man, you had to see this. I wish back then we used to film the lecture. We were not filming. He said, the man is standing here for free, he came, he speaks to you. You don't have one answer or one contradiction to make. He proves to you, I did not know 1% of the things he spoke here tonight. I'm totally blown away, and all you do is, Amos, don't leave us, I'm done with you. He went to yeshiva. 6 months later, I went to Israel, the top Ashkenazi yeshiva for Baalei Teshuva, Netivot Olam. Maybe a year later it was. I went to visit him. I came to the yeshiva. He already had a beard like this. I said, Amos, Harav, Rabbi. So all the Rabbanim look at me and look at him. Who looks the rabbi here? I had to see this. Then he said, I'm taking you to the kibbutz, Bet HaShita. His father told me, listen to me, if you love yourself, don't dare to come here. I'm going to lay in the entrance to the kibbutz with all my friends on the floor. On my dead body you come. A few months later, became religious. Not only that, this story opened the door to make the first synagogue in the most anti-religion kibbutz in Israel. Kibbutz Bet HaShita. All Torah haters that agree to make a shul. You know what a miracle? All the pickles and the olives that you buy, you see. Kibbutz Bet HaShita. That's where they make their money. People changed them. They made a synagogue there. Thanks to Amos Efroni, and then his parents started to realize that the religion is not so bad like they thought. It's all ignorance. All the resistance to the Torah and to Judaism that comes from Jews, it's all ignorance. 100%. Because as soon as you begin to talk to people, they get the shock of their life. The shock of their life. You know, I had one guy, he's Russian. He translated my Torah and science to Russian. He speaks. You know, I have Torah and science, the blue CD, Topa. What's the name of it? Topa.
Torah and science.
No, but in Russian it looks like Topa.
Torah in Auka.
In Auka, yeah. Torah in Auka. That's how it starts. You know, it wasn't religious. Once he translated the film, you had to see how strong he became.
Yesterday I put it on my iPad and I fell asleep. And when I woke up, I realized it was the three of them. I already listened when I was sleeping. Don't ask me. I don't know anything.
You know, one time I got an email from Ukraine. You know, in Poland and Ukraine, they had Jews more than the Germans. Did you know that or no? Polish, they hate Jews the most, and Ukrainian, I don't know about Austria, but it's known that Polish and Ukraine, it's mamash a disaster there. So I get an email from a priest, it's in a church of 5,000 monks, Christian monks, in a mountain of Ukraine somewhere. And he sent to me an email. He said, I watched your Torah and science, and then I watched your debate with a Christian priest, and I realized that all my religion is fake. Now remember, he's a priest teaching people in the church. So I started to teach everything you teach in your weekly classes. I listen to your weekly lecture, I come to the church, and I teach them Torah without mentioning JC. So I became the star of the... So everybody asked me, where you get all these things from? I became very popular now. But the problem is, how long will I be able to go on without mentioning JC here? People come, they talk to me about Father, JC, this, that. So what do you suggest I should do? Should I take my family overnight and run away? Because if they find out I listen to rabbis or anything like this, they kill all of us in a minute. Or I should just continue to take advantage of the time that I still here to teach them the real truth, not the nonsense that I used to teach. So I answered him, based on your question, I already know what's going to happen. It doesn't matter what I will say, because I see already you're a man of the truth. All your life you thought you're following the truth of God. And as soon as someone just showed you in a few hours that you lived in illusion and it wasn't the truth, so now you've discovered the real truth and you see that you already suffer being in that place. So how long do you think you're going to last there? You're not going to be able to stay there that long. It's just a matter of time until you run away. And then he sent me another email or two and disappeared. Now, I don't know what happened to him. Maybe they discovered that he, who knows if he was still alive. You don't know. Maybe he ran away, maybe not. Who knows what happened with him? But just to show you that even someone that was all his life a priest, if he has emet, if he's an honest person, I have nothing to answer. So sometimes, every once in a while, you get a candy, a bonus, a Jew that you pick up, by the way, to make him religious, without effort. Without. One lecture, boom, finished. That's it. Well, most of them, it's a big struggle. Fighting, this, that, on and off, on and off. They go up, they go down, they go up, they go... Time is running out. I started to ask you about the parasha of this coming Shabbat, Toldot. We learn the power of prayer. From whom? Where do we learn it from the parasha? From Yitzchak. His wife, Rivka, is barren. She cannot have kids. Why she's barren? Why Rivka is barren? Huh? I'll give you a few answers. Tell me which one is correct. 1A. Hashem loves the prayer of the righteous people, so he sent them a problem that they should pray. Desire their prayer. B. She got a blessing from her father and brother, the crooks, the idol worshippers, that she should have a lot of children. So Hashem doesn't want people to think that the blessing of these filthy people worth something. So on purpose, he make her barren. And not only that their blessing did not help, actually caused her damage. Right? 3, because all the mothers were barren until a certain point. So which one of the three is correct?
All three.
All three is correct. So now, Rivka is praying for her, for children, and Yitzchak is praying for the children, and the Torah say that Hashem listened to the prayers of Yitzchak. Why? It's not the same, a prayer of a tzaddik, son of a tzaddik, to a prayer of tzaddik, son of Rasha. If you are righteous, and your parent is righteous, you're better than someone that is righteous, that his parent is wicked. I'm sorry. I always learn the other way around. Who is greater? Someone who grew up religious all his life, or someone who grew up like a goy, doesn't know anything from religion, and one day discover it and change his entire lifestyle, became a Baal Tshuva? Who is much greater in the eyes of Hashem? במקום שצדיקים עומדים, במקום שבעלי תשובה עומדים, אפילו צדיקים גמורים אינם עומדים. Even most complete righteous from birth cannot reach the level of בעלי תשובה and converts, which is the same idea. So, in that case, Hashem should have listened to Rivka, not to Yitzchak. No? But what does the Torah say? The Torah says clearly that Hashem accepted the tefillah of Yitzchak. Before I answer it, I want to make up another introduction. The last parasha, Chaye Sarah, it's finished with this pasuk. וישכנו מחבילה עד שור. טה-טה-טה-טה-טה, על כל פני אחיו נפל. Who are they talking about? The Torah speaks about who? Last pasuk in the last parasha. Speaking about Ishmael. Ishmael, the wild beast. Pere Adam, the son of Agar, from Abraham. So his children, the Torah describes how Ishmael, the Arabs, started to spread in a world. Al pene kol echav nafal. Strange. The last word about him, in front of his brother, he collapsed. This parasha, how does this parasha begin? Ve'ele toldot Yitzchak. Ve'ele. And these are the descendants of Yitzchak, son of Abraham. Abraham olidet Yitzchak. This vav shows that there is connection between the beginning of the new parasha to the end of the last parasha. Even without the vav, there's always a connection. The end of one chapter and the beginning of the new chapter are always related. It's not coincidence why those subjects are close to each other in the Torah. But when you have a vav, vav means end. End means it connects to what was before, right? End. Since when you start a story with the word end? Huh? And that means it continues from where we left in the last chapter. The Gemara explained that there's obviously a connection. What does it mean? It's a condition. When Ishmael will collapse in the end of days, the rising of Mashiach will begin. One is connecting to the other, like a seesaw. You know, in seesaw, when one side goes up, automatically one side goes down. So actually you can say when one side goes down, the other one automatically goes up. The Zohar say, remember, this is 2,000 years ago when the Arabs did not have countries, oil, billions of dollars, Kuwait, Saudi, Bahrain, Abu Dhabi, none of that existed. Buildings in Dubai, fancy wealth, Ferraris, tigers in the house. It was all an illusion, a dream. The Arabs were lowlifes that lives in a desert on camel in tents with nothing. Nothing. No science, no advance, no medicine, no education, no alphabet, they didn't know. They all lived in deserts, in the Arabia desert, 2,000 years ago. And the Holy Zohar described that before Mashiach come, they'll take over the world and torture everybody. And that's what we call Chevlei Mashiach. You know when a woman gives birth? The suffering begins the moment she became pregnant. She vomits, this, she doesn't feel good. Then it becomes heavy. It's hard to go up the stairs. And when is the major suffering begin? An hour or two before she gives birth, it begins the contractions. She begins every half an hour. Oh, I felt something. 20 minutes later, again. Then 15 minutes, then 10, then 5. When is the screaming and going crazy? Everyone scream, everyone is in panic. The last minute. Push! I can't! Oh, Moshe! Screaming. Everyone is panic. Get out of the room! Be quiet! I'll kill you! Did I say that? Yes, you say that. I wish I could record you. Record your wife before she gives birth for the first time, because she won't believe half of the things she said. So what happened? Listen carefully what happened here. Just when the torture is the most, the salvation comes. Ah, you hear the baby? In 1 second, nobody even remembers the suffering. Wow. That's it. That's exactly how the salvation with Mashiach would come. That's the good news, that the salvation will be born. But the problem is, before the baby comes, there's a 9 months period of suffering. This is what the Arabs will do to the whole world and obviously to the nation of Israel. But when Mashiach comes, that's the end of it. What? How does Hashem plan the end of Islam and the end of what they do to the world? Leave it to Him. I can tell you that in a prophecy, it's written clearly that it won't have to be like a massive war with armies and this. It doesn't necessarily have to be like that. If the Mashiach comes, 1, 2, 3, even the wicked Jews will all vanish in a minute from His speech. He's just going to say a few verses and they all go on fire. It's written in NIV. How it's going to be, we will know when it's going to be. But the question is, are we going to survive to see or not? That's the main question. If we'll be Mechalel Shabbat, for sure we won't be around to see. For sure. If it's a woman who dressed not modest, Machtiat Arabim, she won't be around to see it. There's some red lines. We all make sins. People that make sins will be around to see Mashiach. Depend what sins. But some sins, it's the end of us. One of them is Mechalel Shabbat. Second, a woman that dressed not modest. You should know, those already, Ya'arek ve'lo ya'avor. When you do it, you're done. That's why my advice to the ladies, whatever you do, make sure two things you never do. Don't ever break Shabbat, and don't ever dress not modest or do sins with guys. And Mary, be faithful to your husband, be a modest woman, keep Shabbat, you already have 90% in your account. Everything else you do will improve your situation and will save you suffering. But if you have these two, you are the queen of the world. And by man, it's much harder. He has to learn Torah every day, he has to keep Shabbat, has to do a lot of other things. Also to be modest, not gamma brit. Tefillin every day. There's a list. There's a long list. By the women, two major things. Remember, this and this, and you're done. You're already in a very good condition. That's why it's so hard for the women to stay modest. It's a struggle every day. She's 10 years wearing skirt, then she comes to her husband, I'm tired, I can't, I need to wear leggings. What's leggings now? 10 years you're dressed. It's cold, all kinds of stupid excuses. It's not comfortable, it's this, it's that. Why? You think the Satan will leave you alone? So it's very interesting. We learn over here something that most people don't know about the power of prayer, and we finish with that. It says like this. We are mistaken in understanding the obligation to pray. We're all wrong. We got it all wrong. I want to ask you a question. Why do we have to pray? Tell me the reason. Why do we have to bring korbanot? But why? So I want to ask you a question. When do we have to pray? When do we have to pray more? You give me wise answers, so I have to make my questions wiser. When do you have to pray more than usual? More than Mincha Shachrit and Arvit? When you have to increase your prayers? He said, when you make sins. No, give me other reasons. When you want something. Already two good answers. No, what else? When you have a problem. You're sick. You lost the money. You cannot find a job. You cannot find a shidduch. Gorbachev is driving you crazy. Something that bothers you, you have to pray. Hashem, help. Right or wrong? Right or wrong?
Yeah,
wrong. Everything you say is wrong. Wrong.
I believe it.
But you see how everybody thinks the same? Everybody agree with him, with him, with me. With.
You have to pray when everything is good in your life. Because that's already good death and you have to pray.
Thank you.
I'm going to read to you word by word and translate. האמת היא, the truth is, שאנו טועים בתפיסה רעיונית. We are mistaken in our idea of understanding. אנו חושבים שישנם בעיות בחיים, ובגללם נאלצים אנו להתפלל. We think we have problems in our life. As results of that, we have to pray to Hashem to take away the problems. לא כן הדבר. It's not true. אלא להפך. The other way around is true. First, Hashem made a rule that a person must pray. That's mitzvah to pray. Talk to me. You're my son. I give you oxygen. I give you life. I want direct connection to you all the time. Pray to me all the time. That's the obligation. ורק בכדי להביאו לידי כך, השם מטיל עליו צרות. And to help you to do what you must do anyway, you get some punches. Moshe, wake up. So Hashem gives problems. You got fired. Rabbi, I got fired. What am I going to do? Pray. Pray, but I pray from the morning to the night. Pray more. Even when your life is supposedly perfect, you have to pray. If you don't pray, Hashem will force you to pray. Why? Because he loves you. Just like a father forces his son to get certain education, send him to a course or something that know that he's going to save his life, he's going to be able to make a living. Or you force someone to do a surgery. Right? You know, it's going to save his life. Sometimes you give an advice to a person, he refuses, you put some pressure on him, then he feels uncomfortable and he listens to you, and then a year later he comes and says, wow, thank you. You have no idea how you saved my life. I gave this advice to few people. Four people, I gave them this advice. Two listened to me and two did not. What was the advice? I'll tell you a story. And like I said, we're done right here. Here, the books are closed, so you can relax. Enjoy the show. Now we're finishing. One time I came to speak in a midrashia for girls here in Brooklyn. I don't know, maybe 12 years ago, maybe more, a long time ago. There was one girl over there. She was very heavy, weight. Very heavy. I don't know, 300 pounds. I don't know exactly how much, but very heavy. So she came to me after the lecture. And she said to me, Rabbi, can you give me a blessing, bracha? I said, yes, what do you want? She said, I want to get married. Me, with my stupidity, or my honesty, or my arrogance, I'm not sure still what it is. I cannot be a faker. It's very hard for me. So I'm going to say to her, I'm thinking in my mind, Et chatai ani maskir hayom, what is the blessing going to help? You need to lose over 100 pounds if you want to get married, because in today's world, men want, not maybe skinny, but at least. So I'm thinking to myself, if I'll tell her, I'll offend her. If I won't tell her, I decree her to stay single for the rest of her life. Because I know, I speak to the guys all the time when they come to talk to me about shiluchim. I know how they think. So I'm thinking to myself, say, I have to do it. Whatever happened, happened. So I say to her, can I give you an advice? They came up with a new surgery now, that you put a special ring on the stomach. A few months later, you can lose 100 pounds. It's going to save your whole life. Trust me when I give you this advice. If you listen to me, it will help you very much. Sure, it's not dangerous. I said, listen to me. Do it and you see the results. She listened. But I didn't know. That's it. I left the place. A few years later, I walk on Main Street. Main Street corner of Jewel. Next to Grill Point Restaurant. Right there in 7-Eleven, I walked in the street. I see a woman that looks like Miss Universe. She runs on the street. Everyone is Jewish around. Like, Rabbi, Rabbi. I never saw this woman in my life. Yes, can I help you? How are you? How's this? How's the family? How's the lecture? I answer, and I'm thinking to myself, who is this woman? Then she realized I didn't recognize her. She said to me, oh my God, you don't recognize me, right? You know this awkward moment that you pretend you know who the person is? But then you run out of excuses. I say, I'm sorry, I don't. I am the girl that you gave me the advice to make the surgery. She became a model. She's married, she has kids already. Baruch Hashem, that's the best advice I did. It changed my whole life. By the way, I lost a lot of, I got married, I have children, my husband makes good living. We all are very happy. So that's good. One guy, one came to me with the same thing. I said to him, listen, I give you this advice. I use her as an example. You're going to do that? It will save your life. Also lost over 100 pounds. Got married, saved his whole life. Two other ones, I also told them to do it. They didn't listen. Both of them singles in their 40s, even today. They didn't get married. So here you go. If there's no question in my mind that if they would do it, they would be already married a long time ago with children. Of course, if Hashem doesn't want, he doesn't want. But I'm talking naturally, in ishtadlut that a person has to do. Because if you know there is a problem in your lifestyle that will make the other side not want you just because of that, you got to do everything you can to do ishtadlut. That's why the Torah allowed plastic surgery. For instance, if a woman has a not pretty nose, she wants to do a nose job, a surgery, is this allowed? You may think, wait a minute, God made me like this. That means he wanted me to look like that. If he wants me to get married, he'll find me the guy who likes me with his nose. That's one logical thinking. Then the other thinking is, in everything in life, we'll do everything we can to look better. We try nicer clothes or makeup that women put, makes them look a little bit better. Why do you need all this? God made you naturally like this. Wear a sack. No makeup, don't fix your hair, and go on a date. If that's supposed to be your husband, don't worry. It doesn't go that way. People have ishtadlut, they do make an effort. Even though from the Torah you can prove other way around. When Rivka came to meet Yitzchak, and they told her, this is your future husband, what did she do right away? Covered herself. Not open the hair. You know? Yitzchak, hi, nice to meet you. No. The other way around. But that was 3,500 years ago. Today it's today. It's a different world. So what do you see over here? So they ask Rav Ovadia Yosef a question. In Yabi Omer, you can see an answer. A girl, an answer for the sake of Shiduchim, you're allowed to do plastic surgery. And then he answered, also for the sake of Shlom Bayit. If a woman is not as attractive in the eyes of her husband, let's say, and she can do, I don't know, all these treatments that they have, assuming it helps. Most of it is baloney and makes the situation worse. But assuming there is some kind of a treatment that will make her more attractive in the eyes of her husband, it's mitzvah to do it. Who can prove it to me from the Gemara? Proof from the Gemara. No? Where does it say that a woman has an obligation to be pretty to her husband? Huh? Very good. Baruch Hashem, we have the rabbi. Came on time to answer. What's the answer? Abba Chilkiah, the grandson of Chonya Ma'agel, who speaks to Hashem and the rain comes down immediately. He speaks to Hashem, 15 minutes later, pouring rain. After years, there's no rain. He speaks, rain comes. His grandfather was also like this, Choni. It's a very special family. They have tight connection with Hashem. Express line. Hashem, come on, we need rain. No problem. Abba Chilkiah, give me a few minutes. Cloud, okay. So he's a very holy man, right? If I speak to Hashem for rain... we will die 50 times before we have rain. But he, oh, then he has a record. Every time they need rain, Abachil Kiya Rabbi, do something. No problem. Hocus pocus, abracadabra, rain comes. So he's a holy man or no? Very holy. Hashem works with him as a team. And his wife came out beautiful, makeup, this, clothes, to welcome him on the street. The rabbis that followed him, they got the shock of their life. They asked him later, why your wife come like this to the street? Not modest. She's getting pretty for me. Why? That I will not have to look at other women. You understand? So from here you see that even a holy person like this that has direct connection to Hashem is much, much holier than the rabbis today. You understand that, right? Everybody understand? No? You understand or you don't understand? It's clear, right? Someone like this that makes rain fall right away. There's no argument about his righteousness. And what does he say in the Gemara? What, he wants to make himself look bad? Why the Gemara brings such a story? Ma, is a humanizer or something? Chas v'shalom? Why do I have to write such thing? To teach us we are not angels and we are not robots. Hashem designed us in a certain way with attractions, with all kinds of desires. And in marriage, it's a part of the marriage. And this part will die, the marriage will die. You understand? That's why I always say, the Gemara says, "Lo nivreu nashim ela leyofi." One of the main reasons Hashem made women is to be pretty. Not to be pretty and be quiet. That's what people added. Tiyi yafa v'tishteki. No, tiyi yafa v'tedabri. You're allowed to talk, you're allowed to do things, everything fine. Just be pretty for your husband, not for the man on the street. For the husband, it's mitzvah all the time. Therefore, if Hashem gave, like Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal say, if Hashem gave the medicine to the disease that did not exist before the medicine, once the medicine became available to humanity, it becomes an obligation to use it. Not a free choice, maybe yes, maybe not. Becomes an obligation. Therefore, if a woman is barren and she cannot have kids, and until, I don't know, 10 years ago, there was nothing to do about it. You don't have kids, you don't have kids, you'll never have kids. Adopt. And now they came up with these techniques that they take the seed from the man's sperm and they take the egg from a woman and fertilize it in a lab and they transplant it inside, and then the woman is able to give birth, and usually it comes with twins or triplets in one shot. It's a miracle. So Moshe Feinstein say, as long as this technology did not exist, that's a decree. That's it. If Hashem made a woman barren, she gets the punishment for whatever reason, and that's it. But now we have the technology to go around that curse or that punishment or that reality. Of course, it's an obligation. Same thing when you have a surgery today that saved life, and 50 years ago, everyone died from it. Today, they move kidneys from a person to another. 50 years ago, they knew how to take a kidney and transplant it to another person and save life. Today they have dialysis. They didn't have it before. Don't use it. Hashem wants me to die. He made my kidney don't work. I have to die. No. Today people lose fingers. They pick up the finger from the place of the hospital. They bring it to the hospital. They wash it. They put all kinds of alcohol. They connect it. And it works. It's not just a dead meat. The nerve system somehow connect. I don't know how they do it. It's a miracle. It's a much divine surgery. They take a dead piece of finger that was 1 hour on the highway on the floor, dirty like this, full of blood. The blood became clogged like this. They wash it, they clean it, and they sew it back. And 10 years later, the person is moving his finger, everything as usual. All kinds of things that medicine got invest and advanced very much. And some people are insisting to suffer. Why? It's very similar to the famous story that the boat was drowning. And they said to a guy, the helicopter, climb on the ladder. The helicopter saved everyone on the boat. And this guy, Moshe, I'm not coming out. Hashem will save me. I don't care. I count on Hashem. They try the boat, they try the helicopter, then he drowned and died. He comes in front of Hashem. I'm so disappointed. Why are you disappointed? You let me down. Why? You made me look like a fool. I screamed to everyone, you're going to save me, you're going to save me. And in the end, I died. Hashem said, you fool. How many more messengers you wanted me to send to you? Send you a boat, I send you a helicopter. That's how I save you. Same thing over here. I save you, I send you this doctor, I send you this technology, I send you this medicine, I send you this painkiller, I send you an epidural. Epidural. Well, you scream, you have pain. I see that women are delicate today. They're not as tough as they used to be. 100 years ago, a woman gave you a punch, you don't wake up for 2 weeks. Today it's a different story. Now you expect her to take the pain? Hashem, send a shot. You okay? You okay? No, no problem. Give me your newspaper. she gave birth reading an article. But back in time, it wasn't like that. Not like some people want to say. If you take an epidural, you're supposed to get the curse of Chava. Betzar til dibanim. So you're going to get the punishment anyway. You're not going to get it giving birth. You're going to have an accident and you break your leg. Because you must get the pain. Not true. Not true. Everything Hashem gave away to avoid pain, or to avoid sickness, or to avoid all kinds of positive things that's supposed to come, and now there is a problem, and Hashem gave a solution. Not only are you allowed to use the solution, it's mitzvah. To use this. Even there's questions among the poskim, if the idol worshiper magician, when they do all kinds of things, hocus pocus, abracadabra, and sometimes it works, if it's allowed or not, to cure a person in an illegal way like this. There's a question, are you allowed to write an amulet on Shabbat? The Gemara brings, a person ate a fish, and the bone got stuck in his throat, and he's coughing and choking, another minute he'll be dead. Back in time, they had such knowledge to write an amulet. A person put it on himself, immediately he comes out, save his life. But you're not allowed to write on Shabbat. Why? Because first of all, what? The amulet is 100% guaranteed to work? If that was the case. It sometimes works, sometimes it doesn't work. But it's definitely works sometimes. So now, if there is a chance to save life by breaking Shabbat, every time you take a person on Shabbat to the hospital, there's no guarantee that the doctors over there will save his life. He still may die. He may die. I broke Shabbat and he died anyway. Or in a surgery, they try to save him and he dies. So there are many things in life that you break Shabbat to save life and in the end you did not succeed. That's no problem. You did what you were obligated. So they allowed to write amulet for someone that known that his amulet work, even sometimes, to save the life of a person from choking, allowed to write on Shabbat. Allowed to drive, so why not allowed to write? You understand how far it goes? Bezrat Hashem. We'll see you next Tuesday for the last lecture before I go to Israel, and then we will be back in Chanukah. Baruch Adonai le'olam. Amen. One more thing. I made, as you know, I finished the series, Way of the Righteous. So we have about 50 hours of lectures here. Part 1 and part 2, as you can see. Now I want you to know, and I repeat it a few times already, there is no chance whatsoever to be really righteous the right way without knowing this book by heart. Many of us think that we're going to be righteous by doing this and this and that. After we review this book, we get the shock of our life. Not only it's not mitzvah, we make a lot of sins not knowing that it's sins. So everybody should take 2 CDs, it's free, don't worry. And make sure you listen to it from the beginning to the end. Baruch Adonai le'olam, amen ve'amen. Free.